Okay, so today I want to do something called generative functions. This is actually something very nice theory. It could be used solving recursions. It could be used for counting things that it's harder to count with the usual way. The idea is compute using a sequence, but instead of dealing with sequence as discrete set of numbers, put this together into a function. So this is let A1, A2, be a sequence of real numbers. This could be also complex numbers, any numbers. Degenerating function for this sequence is the function defined by so the general term looks like this, an x to the n. It's an infinite sum. And first thing about generating functions is that they're not functions. Okay, we treat a generative function as a formal sum. Generating function is not a function. It is just a formal sum. To express infinitely many entries, infinitely many numbers. Now, this is a very important point because it's not a function means that I will never put values for x. So I'm not going to calculate it at 1, 2, 3. I'm not going to calculate it at any x. So I don't have to worry that it converges or not. Because it's not a function. You're not putting values on it. So I'm not going to calculate the sum of infinitely many things, ever. I'm not going to do that. So there is no convergence issues here. Okay. In particular, we are not worried about convergence. We don't worry about convergence. So this is not calculus. It is just a whole different discrete mathematics gadget. We don't need to think about convergence intervals. We don't need to worry about divergence test, convergence test. It's an infinite series, but it's not really a series because it's not a function. We don't put values. Now you may say, but then why it is what it is good for? If you're not going to calculate anything, if you don't know anything about convergence, how does it give us that good computational tool? It gives you a computational tool because you can express many infinite series, many infinite sequences using just one function. So let me explain one example and then we'll do a couple more. So consider the function. Consider the sequence. Say 1, 1, 1, which means the general term is 1. And so on. Now, the generating function for this Now, in the formal way, it is this sum, right? So this is your generating function. But now I don't have to express it like this. I can also say it is equal to 1 over 1 minus x. Because we know that when you multiply these two numbers, you get 1, these two infinite sums. Because This is again discrete mathematics. So I can replace 1 plus x plus x square x cubed with 1 over 1 minus x. It's the same thing, exact same thing. But that means I can even find a sequence, find a generating function, say, for, say, an is equal to n. For all that. So what kind of generative function we're looking for? The fx will be 0, 1x, 2x squared, 3x cubed. And typical term will look like this, an x n. So it turns out that you can find the generative function for this using term-by-term derivatives. We don't put values for x. This is just a formal expression. So we will never put values in x. We are saying this is equal to this because this product is 1. No. We never put values for x, so if I am putting values for x, but I'm not putting values for x.
This is not true for x equals to 5.
Doesn't matter. I never put values for x. So the question is discrete mathematics. If I know this, can I find an? Yes, I can say it's 1, 1, 1, 1. That's all I care. If I can get the sequence out of the function, then it is good. This is all you care. So it's not the equality in the sense that you put values for x. It is a compact way of expressing an infinite number of entries. So instead of putting 1, 1, 1, I will be using this. This is equal to 1, 1, 1 from now on. If I define it as a function from real numbers to real numbers, then I will worry about this. But I don't say it's a function. I told it, it's not a function. So it never takes values in R and gives you values in R. It's a formal expression of numbers. I can actually use the brackets with ones and not use x at all if I want to. X is there just to hold the space because x squared gives you the coefficient of it is exactly a2. And other than that, there is no other purpose for x, just a space locator. Okay. Maybe this will clarify it, but suppose that I want to express infinite sequence like this, 1, 2, 3, n. So normally you will be saying it's 1, 2, 3, n, but now what we can do is we can say that this is x times 1 plus 2x, 3x squared, and n x n minus 1. And then I can say this thing is actually derivative, term-by-term derivative. This is even weirder now, you probably think. We don't have a function, but we talk about its derivative. We can do this again because the derivative is a formal thing as well. So derivative of x to the n is n times x to the n minus 1. That's defined like that. So that means this is something I know. This is 1 over 1 minus x. So I can write this as x times derivative of 1 over 1 minus x. It doesn't matter because once you take derivative, they become zero. So I can add a one there if I want. But now this is the derivative of this, which is minus one times minus one divided by one minus x squared. So I find that the function this is equal to this sequence. And if you give this to computer to calculate the 100th term of this, it will do this. Say you want to find the up to some finite term, 100th term, it will take this x to the 99, 100, it will take this x to the 100, you multiply it, you find the coefficient of x 100 there. And if you multiply these two, you'll see you will get this thing, x plus x, 2x, 3x squared, 4x cubed. So it's exactly the sequence that you wanted to get. So in a compact way, this thing now represents this sequence. It's a compact way of explaining that sequence. Let me show you one application of this. You have to see this in action, otherwise I guess it didn't make sense as much as you may wonder why we all did this. So as an application, I want to solve one of the questions we solve in recursion. Remember this recurrence relation we solved. This is just to show you, like, it could be useful. Okay. Otherwise, we know how to solve this recurrence relation by just taking the roots and writing a general form and so on. Now, suppose we want to solve this by using generating functions. Show you how the generative functions can be used to solve such things. Now, let fx be the generating function for this sequence. Okay. Now, we don't know what ans are, but we know a0, a1, and we don't have any general formula for an. But what we know that it satisfies this recursion. So if you write this in sort of write this in a way that you can see the recursion to get something about fx, then it could be used to find fx. So we want to find fx as a function, without knowing what an is. And from there, we'll calculate an. So to find what fx is without knowing what an is, you have to use this fact that there is this relation. But that relation has shifts, right? An minus 1, an minus 2. To get those shifts, there's a very simple trick you apply to this, which means multiply it with x. So shifts are just multiplying with x. Okay. So you can get a0x, a1x squared an minus 1 xn. See, now you have a shift. I need another shift, so do it with x squared as well. I got two shifts. Now, there's a relation between these rows. The relation says this thing is equal to minus of this thing plus 6 of this thing. So you can actually see that these three rows are related. That means these three things are related. So if you write this again, this says an is this thing holds, right? So that means if I have this thing multiplied with 1, this thing multiplied with 1, and this thing is multiplied with minus 6, and then add them up, I will be getting here as a coefficient an plus an minus 1 minus 6 an minus 2 xn. But that coefficient by the recursion is equal to 0. So it will be true for all of these things after 2. Okay? So after 2, you all get zeros. Which makes it's a nice functional equation. So you get 1 plus x minus 6x squared fx is equal to some earlier missing piece plus zeros. Those missing pieces are easy to figure out. This is minus 1, this is 8. That's why you need initial conditions. So these missing pieces are this. So I can calculate fx. Fx is equal to minus 1 plus 7x divided by this second order. So let me write this down. So fx is equal to minus 1 plus 7x divided by 1 plus x minus 6x squared. Now you may say, okay, I found fx, but how in the world am I going to get an from this? Easy. It actually is a very nice trick that if you have some second order thing here, and if you can factorize this, you can write this as sum of two quotients. So what is this? If you factor this out, what do you get? 1 plus 3x, 1 minus 2x, right? So that means I have some function there, and then some function here. So I can factor this out. Because anytime you have something divided by a times b, you can write this something over a, something as b. Now, you can see that this a and b are very easily calculated because a should satisfy this equation. Because when you get the top, you gotta get this. These equations are same equations you get in the recursion's last step. They're exactly the same equations. But we don't need to know this. So you get a plus b minus 2a plus 3bx equals to this. So that means a plus b is minus 1, and minus 2a plus 3b is 7. And so you find a and b from this. This is easy. 5 is equal to 5b b is equal to 1, then a is equal to minus 2. So you found these numbers. That means I found my fx. Fx is 2 over 1 plus 3x plus minus 2 divided by 1 over 1 plus 2x. Now you may say, I found this, but I still don't know what an is. Now an is very simple, because if 1 over 1 minus x is this, 1 over 1 minus 2x will be exact same thing with x replaced by 2. So you get 2x, 4x squared. So the typical thing will look like 2 to the n, x to the n. So the sequence for 1 over 1 minus 2x is 2 to the n sequence, which means that this has 2 to the n sequence. This thing is minus 3 to the n sequence. So the an for this, you can calculate using combination. So if this is the sequence, so this an can be calculated using the fact that such sequences have 2 to the n as sequences. So from this, you get an is equal to minus 2 times minus 3 to the n plus 1 times 2 to the n. So this is your answer. Basically, find fx first, factor bottom part, write it as 2 sum of 2 rationals with linear terms on the base. And because for linear terms, you know the sequences, they're always 2 to the n sequences, 3 to the n sequences, like some sort of r to the n sequence, you can write the ans in final step by looking what you got. This is one application of generating functions. You can use this to calculate. I'll give you one more application, but I don't want to overtime it. Any questions on this? Is it? I mean, this shows that it could be used to do something. And really, you don't have to worry about convergence or anything. Everything you do here is legal under the assumption that these are not functions, these are formal sums expressing your thing. It's just you're using arithmetic tricks with sequences, but instead of using sequences, you're putting x's here and writing it as a sums. And anything you are writing of this form, this is nothing but just saying that this is a0, this is a1, and so on. But just you're using x's to keep the location. So just to get this, you're using the power sums. So I will show you one more application, but this is a big discussion actually. That book gives an entire section. So I just want to give you a glimpse of it. There's lots of different versions of this, different ways of partitioning of integers, but You can use generic functions to understand this difficult problem. So what do you mean by partitioning integer? Is you want to write your integer as sum of smaller integers. And you allow repetitions. So for example, 2, you can write as 2, or you can write as 1 plus 1. 3, you can write as 3, or you can write as 2 plus 1, or you can write as 1 plus 1. And you don't care about the order. So these are exact same partitions. Okay? So these are same. You don't care about the order. Because if you did care about the order, if you were looking at how many different ways to partition n into k sum n's, we solved these before. This will be a repeated permutation question. So we don't care about order, makes it hard question. So suddenly, you cannot use the old formulas where order was important. So this is something that comes up in number theory a lot, how to partition numbers like this. I actually teach representation theory, and just 1 hour ago we had to partition 6 and 5 into integers to find number of irreducible characters of symmetric groups, S5 and S6. So they come up in many different mathematics. So what you want to know, how many different ways you can partition an integer? Like, so what are these number of rows? Okay, so a partition of an integer n is a way of writing as a sum of smaller integers. So we don't care about the order, it just doesn't pay attention to the order. So this is your definition. And then Pn be the denote the number of partitions. Okay. So what you see here is P2 is 2. Two different ways of partition. P3 is 3, P4 is 5, and P5 is 7, I believe. So there's numbers. I mean, there's no, you may be tempted to say that it's Fibonacci or something, but it changes from the Fibonacci. P5 is 7. So you might be asked to calculate P100, and you may just say, I can do it by checking the cases, but P100, it's not that easy, because you cannot set up induction by saying that suppose the last number is 1 or 2, because there's no last number. There's no order. So you cannot do induction here. You cannot talk about induction. But still, you want to be able to, say, tell your computer to give you a coefficient, or the P100, in an efficient way. How do you set up an algorithm to calculate P100? Like, you want to, say, write a small program which gives you P100. One way you can do this is to find a generating function. If your generating function is explicit enough, you can always tell your program to calculate the generating function's 100 coefficient, and then you will get your P100. So we can focus on the generating function. The generating function. Now, if you're lucky, if you can find the compact formula for P, this fx, then you will be done, because you will tell the calculate these multiplications and you will get P_ins. And even though fx may be complicated, maybe you can focus on parts of it which is finite. Like if you want the 100th term, you can only calculate some of it as well. So it turns out that there is a very nice compact formula for fx, which is this. So this is the result formula for fx. It's actually infinite. That's this. I mean, it is still infinite, but you can see that you can actually calculate any number you want if you know this is equal to this. So we had something that we had hard time to calculate. Actually, there is no formula I can write in terms of n which says Pn is this. So there is no formula because it involves infinite many products. Cannot give a formula for Pn this way. But now, because I wrote a formula for fx, I essentially gave you a recipe how to calculate Pn for any given number, any number you want. So why this is true? So why is this true? So we'll explain why is this true, and then this will be very much there. Any ideas why it could be true? Okay, let's try this. Some way, let's try to explain this product in a way that it will give you two partitions as coefficients. So just make a sort of trick out of this multiplication. So what we know is that 1 over 1 minus x is 1 plus x, x squared, and so on. So we know that it is 1 plus x, x squared, and so on. And then this one is same thing with squares. And then this thing is with cubes. So I can actually write this as if you look at this product, why in the world the coefficient of xn to be pn? There seems like no reason. Because you have, so you can see that the first number is 1, but the coefficient of x will be just this, coefficient of x squared this. So it's not that easy to.
Böyle bir şey olabilir mi? Hı hı. Mesela 1 için baktığınızda 1 olması lazım. Yok, 1 için sadece tek ileri çarpmam lazım. İşte içleri 1 için, şey, içleri 2 için mesela 1 çarpıyorum, bir de diğer 1 çarpıyorum.
You are explaining exactly the argument. So, so we want the. I will rephrase what you just said. So we want this to be p1x, p2x square, p cube x cube. And some way this should be these numbers, and this should be these numbers. So some way the number of ways to get x square from this product should be exactly two different ways. Number of ways getting p cube, x cube, should be equivalent to this number of ways of writing 3. Same way, let me do one more line, p4, x4. It should be number of ways getting x4 from these products should be exactly equivalent to these rows. To see this very clearly, instead of writing this as 2, write it as 1 plus 1. And then this is 2 plus 2. So now you know which row they come from. This is what. So basically, this way, I know that which row they come from. Okay? So here, x6 is different than x6 here, because this x6 was coming from the x2 row, which means it comes from 2 plus 2 plus 2, where this x6 comes from 3 plus 3. So by this way, we know that if something comes from this row, it is from the 3 plus 3. Now look at how many different ways you can get x squared. You can get it like this, x1 plus 1, or you can get it x2. There is no other way to get it. Look at how many different ways you can get this one. You can get as x cube, or you can get as x2, x1, or you can get it x1, 1, 1. This. And then you can look at x4. You can get it on x4 directly, with some ones, but you can get it as x3 times x1, or you can get it as x2 plus 2 from this, or you can get it as x1, 1, 1, 1 from here, or you can get it as x squared times x1 plus 1. But there is no other way of getting x to the 4. And these are exactly these numbers. Did I get all the numbers? 2, 2. Sounds missing. So I get 5 numbers. And P4 was 5. So this explains why it is true. There was a question, again a historical question. Somebody asked, but you can give it to a computer and we'll calculate P. I mean, it's at least a formula. I mean, but of course the formulas. Good for computation, but they're also good for showing things. So one of the things that was a problem or question was this became a theorem later. The number of partitions of n, which uses only odd numbers. So you can strict to the only odd numbers, which, as you see, the now not all the partitions are available You can only use odd numbers means this is available and this is available. Here you only have this available and this is available. Here you only have this available. Number of partitions which does not have any numbers appearing twice. And this is completely different thing because now you don't allow repetitions with no repetitions. So now you have this one and this one. And here no repetition, you have this one, and that's all. And here you have this one. So there are different numbers that we're talking about. And it turns out that these two are equal. And there is no really map between them. So if you take an odd number partition, you cannot find a partition which has no repetition. Or if you take a partition which has no repetition, you cannot find this. But it turns out these numbers are equal. And the only way you can prove them is to find their generating functions and then show they're equal. And it turns out that the generating function for this one only involves these odd powers, and the generating function for this one only involves no repetitions, so it looks like this. So you have generating function theory helping you to find generating functions for these two things which you don't have formulas for. So like this first generating function fx is just this function which only uses these odd powers, and this is the coefficients of this function gives you the partitions, uses only odd numbers. And the generating function for the second one, it does not have these infinite sums. It only has the numbers like just next to it. Now it turns out that to show that these two are equal, all you need to do is to show these two generating functions are equal. But because you have formulas, you can start with one of them and say, okay, then if I put the squares to this formula, I can get all the numbers below. By just adding the even powers to both sides, I still have the equality. But now these even powers separates like this. No, it's too bad. So I have this. 1 over f1x. This is f1x. So I multiply top and bottom one with even powers. But now I have all these numbers, all these summands in both places. Oops. So when you cancel them out, you get only these things. Which is exactly this f2x. So by a simple trick of writing generating functions and multiplying them and canceling certain things, you can show that the generating functions for these two counting problems are equal, so the numbers has to be equal. But there is no other explanation why these numbers are equal, because they cover the different sets. Like The red ones, you have two of them. Here you have two of them. But there is no really reason why they match. Okay? So genetic functions can be used to get things like that. Without really knowing what your an is, you can show it's equal to some bn without knowing even what bn is. So you can show two things are equal without knowing what they are. So it's useful. I mean, if you're interested, you can read it further from the book. But some of the professors teaching this course, they actually use a lot more generating functions for early calculations we do. So some of these things we did at the beginning, you can use generating functions to redo them. So it's a very, very useful technique. All for now.